Hello viewers, welcome to the channel once again. This video is actually dedicated for our new class 9th students. As I remember, there's a video that I made earlier for class 9th. And in that particular video, I talked about that act 1, scene 1 of Merchant of Venice. So I thought to develop on the syllabus. So in connection to that, today I'm going to give you a brief introduction to that the scene of act 1, scene 2. But before starting with act 1, scene 2, let us first recapitulate the incidents that we have already discussed in act 1, scene 1. So if you remember, act 1, scene 1, the play, it starts in a street of Venice. And we come across three characters, namely Salarino, Salanio, and one of the most important characters of the play, that is Antonio. And if you remember that act 1, scene 1, it actually begins with the melancholic mood which we come across, where we come across Antonio is having a very sad mood, but the point is that he doesn't know what is the reason actually why he is sad. So in that particular case, the two other characters, Salarino and Salanio, they kept on guessing now what can be the possible reasons for Antonio being sad. And they guessed, if you remember, one of them, I think probably Salarino, who says that maybe Antonio is thinking too much about the safety and the security of his ships, and that is why probably he is sad. The other one, Salanio, who says that maybe Antonio is in love and that is why he is sad. But both the reasons are being actually rejected by Antonio, and suddenly the conclusion is made that Antonio is sad because he is not happy. And there's a philosophical statement that is made, if you remember, where Antonio says that this world itself is a stage where he has decided to play the role of a sad man. Then we came across, if you remember, there's the entry of the three other characters, namely Lorenzo, Graciano, and our hero of the play, Bassanio. So it is Graciano who actually tries to who makes an attempt to change the mood of Antonio by saying that if you have decided to play the role of a sad man, I would like to play the role of a jolly man, a man who will always crack some jokes to make people laugh. So any your choice, towards the ending of the scene, if you remember, actually we come to the main plot. The other day in the last video, if you remember, I talked about such plots and all, something called main plot and subplot. So and I talked about that main plot, which actually involves Bassanio's attempt, Bassanio's journey to Belmont to take part in the game of caskets, and because of which he was in need of some money, and that is why there's this connection in the last part of that act one, scene one, where Bassanio comes to Antonio with the hope of getting some loan so that he can make his desire to go to Belmont to be a realistic one. But sadly, Antonio, who confirms that all his money, that the wealth that he has already invested them in his business, which runs in the sea through the ship. So presently he doesn't have any money. And if you remember the scene, it ends where both of them, Antonio actually suggests that to go and to search for some people, or rather some merchants of Venice, seeking for the loan. Now let's start with this, the scene which I have planned to start today. Now act 1, scene 2. So if you remember the last video, I talked about something called settings. Now settings, rather there are two geographical locations where the scenes, they revolve around. So it is something like act 1, scene 1, where we were in another one particular setting in Venice. But we need to remember that even in Venice also there are multiple locations where the play or the scenes will take place. So in that scene, act 1, scene 1, we were at one particular street. If we go on to another scene, that is act 1, scene 3, that we will remain in Venice but not in the previous setting. That setting will change. But the exception with this act 1, scene 2, where once again we are introduced with a new particular setting, that is not in Venice but in Belmont, in Portia's mansion, in Portia's house. So the scene there's a connection with the beginning of both the scenes, Act 1, Scene 1 and Act 1, Scene 2. For your easy understanding, you need to remember that Act 1, Scene 1, it actually begins with the melancholic mood of Antonio. But this scene, Act 1, Scene 2, it once again, it begins with the melancholic mood of Portia, where Portia, in case of Antonio, he doesn't know or he didn't know what is the real cause of his sadness. But out here, the audience, we come to know that why Portia is sad. Now, Portia is sad because of the condition of the cascades which was planned and devised by Portia's dead father. So thereby, this particular scene, actually, it introduces the cascades or the game of cascade to the audience. So the game of cascade, it is something like that. It is a device which was actually planned by Portia's father, and he wrote in his will that whosoever, any individual who is willing to marry, he will have to fulfill this, you know, this condition of the cascades. So what is that cascade condition is all about? So namely, there are three cascades, gold, silver and lead. And as the condition is concerned, in one of the cascades which will be containing a portrait, a picture of Portia, the person who will choose the correct cascade, the cascade which will be containing the portrait of Portia, only he will have the authority to marry Portia. So like every coin has got two sides, this condition has also got two sides. If we see this from the point of view of Portia, so Portia, towards the beginning of the scene, Act 1, Scene 2, she is rather sad. She starts by saying to her maid servant Nerissa, another important character of the play, she says that she is actually tired now. She feels tired because of the hard bound condition that was devised by her father. So because of this condition, the word choose or select, the word has been deleted from the dictionary of Portia, because on the one hand, because of the condition, she can neither choose a person if she likes, at the same time she can't also reject a person whom she doesn't like, but if the person successfully chooses the correct cascade. So throughout the scene, we also come to know that the suitors, whosoever are willing to take part in this game of cascade, the person has to take some oaths, basically three oaths. So it is something like that. The person who is willing to take part in the game of cascade, the first oath that the person has to take, that he will never reveal that which particular cascade he has chosen is in his attempt. So maybe it is gold, silver or lead. The person has to take the oath that he will never reveal that which particular cascade he has chosen throughout his attempt. The second condition is that the person who will be unsuccessful in choosing the correct cascade, the person will never approach to any other maid, any other woman for marriage. So the person will, with the losing of the game of cascade, the right to get married is also being taken away from the suitors. Number three, the person who fails to choose the correct cascade, without any counter argument, the person will have to leave Belmont immediately. So these are the three oaths that a person has to take, a suitor who is willing to take part in this game of cascade. So towards the ending of the conversation between Portia and Nerissa, Nerissa actually tries to console Portia by saying that actually it is an intelligent device. Portia's father probably was an intelligent man, and he thought something which can happen even in the future also. So according to Nerissa, she says that the intellectual father of Portia had devised the condition. Actually, the person who will have genuine love for Portia only, and who can read the inscriptions which are written in the casket correctly and comprehend it, only he will choose the correct casket. So thereby, as I have mentioned out here, There are already a number of suitors have already taken part in this game of casket. Okay, now but out here Portia and Nerissa, they actually talk about six suitors who have already reached to Belmont, okay, and they are waiting for their departure. So it's every name that is taken by Nerissa, Portia gives her version, and she finds faults with every individual whosoever have reached to Belmont. So first Nerissa takes up the name of a particular prince that is called Neapolitan prince. Now Neapolitan prince, Neapolitan, a man from Naples. So this particular prince, Portia has got a lot of problem. According to Portia, this man, he loves his horse too much that he can never love the lady whosoever he will choose. So then she comes to talk about the County Palatine. Now County Palatine, according to Portia, that this man is very sad, okay, he is always very very serious, and she would never like to get married to such a person. Now suddenly they come to the third prince who has already taken part in this game of casket, that is French Lord. Once again Portia has got a lot of problem by saying that she says that French Lord is too much moody, okay, no one knows that at what time he'll behave in whichever way. So finally Nerissa takes the names of two other, one is English Baron, other one is Scottish Lord. Portia's problem with these two lords, actually both of them, they spoke in English as well as in the English Baron and the Scottish Lord. Even in Scotland also the spoken language that is prevalent there in Scotland, that is also English. But according to Portia, she says that she couldn't even comprehend what they actually they tried to express themselves, because she has got a very little grasp of English. And finally the German Lord, where Portia also expresses her detaste for the Lord. So we come to know from Nerissa that actually none of these suitors, they actually have taken part in the game of casket, because they were worried, they were scared of the on the ground that if they fail to choose the correct casket. If you remember, I started talking about this game of casket regarding three oaths. So the person will have to leave Belmont at once, the person will never marry any other woman, and the person will never reveal the particular casket that he has chosen. So by listening to that that condition, that anyone who is willing to take part in this game of casket, the person has to take these oaths. These six suitors, actually they taken back their names, they have already withdrawn their names, and they are ready for their departure. And once again we get a hint towards the ending of the scene that Portia is already aware about Bassanio, and Nerissa she gives the account that once when Portia's father was alive, there was a man called Marquis de Montferrat from Venice, and Bassanio, our hero, who have already paid his visit to Belmont. So now there's a soft desire in Portia, that you can see that she's actually willing if that man Bassanio once again he returns to Belmont and he takes part in this game of casket. But basically the scene ends with the entry of a servant with the news that there's a new suitor is already he has already started his journey to come to Belmont, and probably by tomorrow morning the new suitor, that is Prince of Morocco, will arrive. And this Prince of Morocco is one of the most important characters of the play, who will actually solve the confusion that the audience have regarding the gold casket. So in the next video we are going to talk about that act 1 scene 3. Thank you.